If you thought that making money on scientific publishing is the only one dark side of academia, you have not probably heard about the scientific metrics data, which also can be sold to public academic libraries that we all fund by paying taxes. The 60s were a time when major changes in scientific communication occurred, like Robert Maxwell, which started money-making business on scientific publishing, about which we discussed in our previous episodes. There was Jen Garfield, which founded a company called Institute of Scientific Information, ISI. This company was selling a list of citations or references from scientific papers to the university libraries. Of course, logically, ISI got an agreement with publishers that can provide those citations, and they can work together by forcing libraries to pay for their services. Up at the time, digitalization and adoption of ISI by Clarivate Analytics, the new product appeared, the Citation and Journal Database Web of Science, which is now successfully integrated to the routine and budgets of libraries. Elsevier, one of the biggest scientific publishers, also made its own research database called Scopus. Why are libraries buying this information? What are the impact factors? H-index. Should we agree with the fact that the data collected from public research is sold by commercial companies back to the public libraries? Are there any alternatives for the democratic and fair scientific metrics? Let's discuss it with our guest, Stefaniia Dawson. This is the first part of our interview with her. My name is Stefaniia, and you're watching Open Science TV. Stefaniia Dawson, German-American former biologist which switched to German literature and scientific publishing, and decided to co-found an independent startup in Berlin and Boston called ScienceOpen, which on Stefaniia's opinion is believed to transform the way scientific communication works in a completely digital way. ScienceOpen provides services for publishers, institutions, and individual researchers to promote their articles, journals, posts, research, and sort publications, create collections. According to Stefaniia, ScienceOpen is made to show the real power of the open access, where all can benefit from.
Can you explain what this science metrics means, actually?
I mean, science metrics in a really broad sense, and that there have been, you know, lots of books and studies and but in a broad sense, I would define science metrics as really a way to create tools to analyze how impactful certain pieces of research have been, and to understand which pieces of research have been particularly influential in their field. And of course, you mentioned Eugene Garfield. Of course, his the tool that he created was the impact factor, to basically use citations as a way to measure how other research has built on top of a particular research paper. Which research papers have become really hubs of creating new research, and which topics were dead ends or were not very influential. So from the very beginning, scientists always, the whole principle of science is that you really are building on the research of others. And nobody's starting their science project in a vacuum. And one of the first things that you learn is, well, cite your sources. Where did you get that information, and how are you building on it? And so citations were really a natural place to start if you're trying to create a metrics of how impactful a piece of research is. But of course, at the beginning, there simply weren't the tools that we have today. So at the beginning of Web of Science, and you know, even in 2000 when I went into scientific publishing, many companies were still sending a copy of the print journal to Web of Science, and editors there were like typing the references into a database. So there's a huge, it was a hugely labor intensive project to just, you know, get the transfer from paper to some kind of a database where you could start measuring the number of citations, etc. So at the beginning, you know, it simply wasn't with so much, it simply wasn't very precise. You know, they really couldn't have told you, this paper has this many citations and this paper has only this many citations. And so the impact factor is defined as the number of citations in a single year for the last divided by the number of articles of the last 2 years. So with the idea that if you have a citation index of one, on average papers over the last 2 years were each cited one time. But the reality of that is, of course, that one paper was cited 100 times and 100 papers were cited zero times. But, you know, on the average, the impact factor is one. And this has been one of the big critiques of the impact factor, of course. For historical reasons, because that was the measure that they had, the impact factor really took off and became when you talk about science metrics, the impact factor is the metric that researchers still in 2020 are being measured against. The average number of citations of articles in the journal that they published in, which is it's a rather artificial and really just rather lucky also as a journal editor. I mean, we also were hoping to get that paper that was suddenly going to change the system. And we knew we just needed one, right? We just needed one paper that was going to be, that was going to suddenly spark a whole new line of thought. And then our impact factor could jump by multitudes if we got that one paper, even if everything else stayed the same. So certainly working in the publishing industry in journals, I mean, every year we had long discussions of, you know, how can we increase our impact factor? But of course, the system is really not very useful or helpful for researchers. And yeah, there's all kinds of reasons why the impact factor is highly problematic, and also increasingly so in an open access world, right? Increasingly so where journals can, you know, simply pay more for more marketing, for to get their name more well known, and can simply charge as soon as they get an impact factor, can increase their APCs by a huge amount. So there's all kinds of things about the impact factor that are also, I think, particularly toxic in this sort of, as we move towards open access.
Open Science TV tends to adopt transparent financial management and independency. If you want to financially help and support our project, you can use the Open Collective platform, which allows to collect and spend money openly. Choose your contribution tier, and your name will be featured on our next episodes.
Okay, so it seems that while this like private companies, they're doing this science metrics and measuring impact factor, it's also not, it's like not fair, because as you mentioned that they can invest a lot of money on promoting and etc. But in the same time, it's not like transparent, because no one knows what they are doing or what kind of a model or system or algorithm they are using in their, or it's kind of transparent.
I think it's, I mean, there have been, you know, sort of critiques about the ways in which publishers and also the big players, Scopus, Web of Science, the ways in which, I mean, really only Web of Science is the one that kind of owns the impact factor. But I think one of the interesting things is that, you know, it's very, very difficult to get your journal accepted into Web of Science so that they start tracking your citations.
And you need to pay for this, yeah? You need to pay for your journal being registered.
No, you can't pay for it. Of course, everybody would pay for it right away, right? Nobody would. They have very strict criteria. You have to publish a certain number of years. You have to have a certain number of citations already. They have some real quality criteria that they say, okay, we're only going to accept this small number of journals. So they are only tracking citations then from a small subset of journals. And of course, because you can imagine, at the beginning, every journal that they accepted meant, you know, they maybe needed another editor to type in in references, but in the current system, they really are quite exclusive. It's a mark of high quality to get accepted to Web of Science, and then what they do is, you know, they extract all of that information from those papers, and then sell that to libraries and for.
That's how they got money.
So that's how they get money. I mean, I think it costs roughly around $100,000 for a mid to large university per year to have a subscription.
In addition, they pay for science metrics, like libraries, they pay for science metrics, they also pay for subscriptions, like
they have to pay for the Web of Science subscription. I mean, it's very expensive. It's hard work, and it's very expensive to do all of this data crunching and get all of those numbers together and, you know, make them discoverable in a certain way. But the one you know, sort of thinking about this in terms of open science is that publishers publishing content with copyright protection. So we would not be able to access the full text of that and extract those references. Only Web of Science can do that because they enter into a contract with the publisher, and the publisher, of course, wants Web of Science to extract those references and give them an impact factor. But they have then, you know, sort of exclusive access to a bunch of citations that other players don't. So this is one of the cool things about open access. If those articles are really out there, freely accessible with a Creative Commons license, then companies like ScienceOpen and others can access that information that is really embedded in those references. So that's where it starts getting interesting from an open science, open citation perspective, because they simply have access to references that other that other people don't. And they use that exclusive information that they have to create products that they can then sell to the library, but that are then used for, you know, to judge researchers all around the world, many who are at universities maybe that don't even have Web of Science, where people are being very much judged on by a system that is quite closed, but nevertheless it's being used as like the default metric for job progression, career development, etc. So that I think is something where a lot of the community, and particularly the open science community, has been working really, really hard, also with publishers who even do have copyright material, to say, look, the references don't have to be, couldn't we see the references as part of the metadata? So couldn't we see those citations as something that is part of the public, the title, the author, the author's affiliation? These are all pieces of metadata that are freely available, freely accessible, because how else would anybody find the paper, right? So the publisher is clearly wants to make at least these pieces freely available. So that's when I'm talking about metadata. That's what I'm talking about. The pieces, the information about the paper, the authors, the title, the license, the abstract, and many, some people define the abstract as part of the metadata. Others say, ooh, that's copyrighted, so we're not going to share that. And so that's been, over the past few years, really driven by a great initiative that we're also part of, the I4OC initiative for open citations, that has been really pushing to make citations part of the open, freely accessible metadata, so that you don't have this situation of this closed system between publishers with copyrighted material and Web of Science with a copyrighted database, you know, creating science metrics that are not then transparent in this way. I mean, you can really pretty easily understand how the impact factor is calculated, what the data that's been used to create the impact factor, et cetera. But unless you have a subscription, you can't actually look at any of that data. So I think that's one of the things that we've been actively involved in trying to change.
This is the end of the first part of our interview with Stefaniia, where we discuss the impact factor and why it is not fair to use it nowadays and why we need to find an alternative to it. Subscribe to our channel, turn on the notification bell, comment and share this video. Help us to promote open science principles and practices by following us on Twitter, Facebook, Instagram and Telegram. Support our project and donate on the Open Collective platform. Links are below in the description. Thank you, and see you soon. Bye.